Hi guys, to everyone, I'm Ada from Poison Rock, and today we have a legend, we can say Mark Boals, with us. It's really a pleasure. And first of all, Mark, how are you?
I'm great. Everything's fine here. Thank you for the nice introduction.
I mean, you are a legend. We can't discuss on that for sure. Of course, I want to start off, I mean, with the beginning. So how you approached music, because of course your musical career is stunning. So let's starting from the beginning, because as far as I know, you have on your influences as well classical music, and you were interested in a bass as instrument you played as well. So how is, just let's make a little bit of story about your career as a musician.
Well, I started out playing bass and singing. Actually, I started singing first because I started singing in church when I was five. I sang solos in church and started recording myself on my dad's tape recorder when I was a little boy to hear how I would sound and try to make it better, even when I was 5 years old. And then when I was about eight, a friend of mine was playing bass and he got a new bass and he said, "Oh, you want to play bass?" And he gave me a bass, so I started playing bass along with records and stuff, and I eventually started playing in some bands, and started playing with you know, some adults when I was maybe 12 or 13. I started sneaking in the back door of a bar to play, you know, with the cover bands,
and like a kind of a jamming, sneaking into the adult pub.
And I loved it more and more, and it turned out that most of the bands, well, all the bands that I was with, the singers weren't that great. So I started singing and playing, and eventually I started singing all the songs. And I stayed a singing bass player for many, many years with Selway Brown, with Ted Nugent. And then when I went with Yngwie, I just sang.
Yeah, and that's, of course, the core. I mean, because of course you have an amazing career, solo career. We are gonna dig a little bit, of course, because there is a release. But of course, speaking about, we can say the 80s, because in 84, your career basically brings you to collaborate and recording Trilogy with Yngwie Malmsteen, which is considered one of the masterpieces in music. So how was, I mean, back then, I mean, if you see with, of course, back then I was it, and today, seeing with your eyes of today, how was that period of, as well, recording and working with him, of course, with your vocal skill as well?
Well, overall, I mean, the whole scene, I was in Los Angeles in California, and that was the central place for metal and rock in the 80s. I mean, all through the 80s. It was right in the middle of the 80s when I was doing the album when I got with Yngwie. Record companies were still paying lots of, we had a $6 million record deal with PolyGram. And well, the manager stole most all of it, but that's typical. Yeah. But we recorded in the big studios, and we were out on the Sunset Strip, you know, meeting fans every night, because every night the whole Sunset Strip was full of people every night, 7 nights a week. From the whiskey, it was a stretch of this road from the whiskey to the rainbow.
And it was the Sunset Strip. Yeah,
it was really it's nothing like that now. It'll never be like that again. It was a magical time.
Yeah, and I will ask you about some, no, I'm going to ask you now, just about some nice memory do you have about that period in the 80s, for example, in the Sunset Strip as well, during all the night concert gigs, because it's a really important that fans, people, young guys know that, remember that, can at least dream, because we all dream about that amazing period for the 80s music.
Well, I was hanging, you know, when we weren't playing or in the studio, and I was down there, we were down there on the strip every night, because that was the place to be, and that's what we thought we were supposed to do, and that was the fun thing to do. So I would sit at a table with Vince Neil and drink, and I would hang out with David Lee Roth, and hang out with Sammy Hagar. Everybody that was anybody was out there that much. I mean, Sammy Hagar was more up in the San Francisco area, but I met him when we played at Oakland Stadium, and he played me demos for the Van Halen album 5150 that he was just writing songs for. So it was a lot of really fun stuff. It was really fun.
It basically was like every time you went, even if you were going out alone, you basically met friends. It became like a huge family. All that period.
You run into everybody around there, around Hollywood that time. Yeah. Everybody here.
Yeah, of course. Coming back a little bit in your career, after we can say coming back with Ingrid play, you basically with your former project, The Billionaire Boys, basically you collaborated with George Fisher from Accept. What, in your opinion, your way of singing changed in this project? That from, for example, the when you record the trilogy?
I don't think so. I mean, I really had a lot of fun making that album, and I wish that would have continued because it was really fun music. I mean, some of the lyrics were sweet, but it was such a fun thing. And I really, when I sang on that album, if I don't know if it sounded different, instead of being in the big studio for that, I recorded, it was the first time I recorded in my house, and they trucked in all this equipment to my house. It wasn't like nowadays when you do everything on the computer. No, we had to bring the big the big mixer, but nobody was around. So instead of having the mic on a stand, I had the big Neumann microphone. I was jumping around singing like this.
So you can feel the energy in those records.
Yeah,
that's beautiful.
Maybe I should do that now.
If you do it, because it's amazing, because you can feel the energy and the power of the moment when you're recording, and you can pass it to the people and they feel it. It's kind of exchange of energy, so something like that.
I'm surprised you noticed that. Nobody's ever said that to me before, so but now that I think, interesting.
It's something really, I think that more musicians should do something like that, because it, you know, sometimes it's like we back to the past. We all the time, we love how they were the 80s, the 90s, but in the meantime, we use the same technology. But what if we try to once use how it was recorded back in the 80s or 90s? It would be something different, and as well, we can say, a new way of teaching, the new generation of learning, we can say, most of that. And it's with big musicians like you that the new generation, including myself, learned the music, the story of music, the history of music. And of course, speaking always about, because one album that you did with Ingwe, it's in 1997, it's Inspiration. That basically, it's a kind of covering this huge, you can say, colossal music from different bands. How did you find, how did you feel to record and sing, like, I don't know, Scorpions, Deep Purple in songs?
Well, these guys, those bands were bands I learned from. I mean, Ian Gillan was one of my first idols, you could say, of singers. Yeah. I studied everything that he did, and I just loved how he was the first rock singer that I heard doing the high screams, like James Brown used to do. All of a sudden, Ian Gillan is doing that.
It was so cool.
So, yeah, I studied him a lot. I mean, and Yngwie, I'm sure, even though he doesn't say so, he studied Ritchie Blackmore a lot too. So,
I mean, that's all the main influences. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course, and I mean. Basically, you did some other albums with Ingrid, because, of course, I mean, it's like a long love career that both of you did it. And if you can just really make a kind of summary, or just tell in a few words your experience with him, how would you like to describe it? Because, of course, changing during the year, so we can say maybe 15 years of working together, of knowing both even more. So.
Well, you know, it's a bittersweet kind of thing with Yngwie, because there's a lot of good times and a lot of bad times.
Because that happens with every relationship.
So talented, so extremely talented, and so stubborn and opinionated and a control freak kind of guy too. Yeah. So it was difficult a lot of times, but it was magical moments too. I mean,
yeah,
it's funny because when we were making albums back then, I would go to Miami and we'd hang out for a month or two at his house, and we'd be drinking beer and playing video games and playing tennis and going to the beach, and it was like kind of like we live in the 80s a little bit, like in Miami, and we got along great. But then when it came time to do business stuff, it was not fun because he'd be really, really stubborn.
That's perfectionist, you know, sometimes musicians, there are some types of musicians that amazing, of course, they have this perfectionism, that's their kind of, you can say, lifestyle, and that there are other more rock and roll musicians, which are, you know, like, I play and sing however they want. But anyway, your collaboration with him, it's like, we can say, one of the, it's huge. It's, and as in well,
beginning when I worked with Yngwie, he would say, just, you're great, man. Just do whatever. Just sing whatever. Do whatever, you know. And it was a collaboration, more of a collaboration.
Yeah.
And then as time went on, he became more like, no, you do this and this and this.
Okay.
And it was kind of constricting, you know. And I mean, in some ways it was good because I'm kind of a perfectionist too, but not to the degree where I think I'm always right.
I mean, of course, you have your own...
other people's opinions, and then I do what I think is best. And sometimes I take a lot of advice because there's a lot of people that are smarter than I am. But he's in the mindset where he's the only one that knows what's right. So that's the difficult part.
Yeah, and I mean, you had as well. I mean, different project. You did the project Royal Hunt, which you released two albums, and as well with your collaboration, there is as well. Uli John wrote, it's a lot of collaboration, but of course, which are amazing. So if you want to say something about that as well, this brief period, for example, with Royal Hunt or Uli.
Oh yeah, well, those are both really good times. I had no problem with either one of those guys. I'll start with the Royal Hunt because that came before Uli, I believe. And Andre Anderson, it's basically his band, and He lost, like, Marcus Jadel was a guitar player when I was in the band. He was a genius guitar player. And he left the band because he wasn't allowed to collaborate, because he produced and writes, and he didn't want it. He promised to collaborate with him, and then he didn't. And I came in, and I was open to any experience that needed to happen, because I loved their music, and I thought Andre's a genius too. However, after I did the second album, I kind of felt like he was pushing me in a direction of singing that wasn't really me. And I felt like I didn't fit the band as well as DC. I suggested to him that DC Cooper was the perfect singer for Royal Hunt because they have a certain Scandinavian sound and they had established. And his voice was kind of, I think, what Andre was always looking for, and they had some, you know, problems working together. So that's why he went with some different singers like John West and himself. John is a great singer too, but I don't think he fit the band as well as DC Cooper, and I don't think I did either. But I think those albums were great, and I had a great time with them. And now, moving on to Uli is like one of the greatest geniuses I ever worked with, and he's the only one that Yngwie admits to being an influence. Yngwie idolizes Uli, and Uli, I had some experiences with them both being together, and Yngwie said, I play this riff just like you, and Uli would say, no, you have to play it this way, and Yngwie go, oh, he'd be so embarrassed. But the album I did with him, it was a little disappointing because it didn't come out as good as it should have, because again, Uli mixed it, and he's not a mixer. He's a great musician. He can play any instrument there is, and he's a fantastic guitar player as well as violinist and everything else. But we recorded his castle in Germany.
Wow.
It was a huge castle. It was amazing.
Beautiful.
Out in the country, it had a private lake, a clock tower, it had a guest house, 7-bedroom guest house.
Yeah.
I don't know how many rooms were in the castle, like over 50 rooms, I think. we recorded in the ballroom. He brought the
ballroom
there in a
choir. You have as well a dance floor?
Well, it was a giant room with, you know, with the crystal shack.
Yeah. That's the atmosphere felt almost majestic, really.
Yeah, and he had a lot of stories. An amazing guy. His sweetheart. I love that guy. Nothing but praise for him. We never had a difficult moment with him at all. I just was disappointed that he didn't get a proper mixer guy to mix the album, because he had an idea about how the orchestra should blend with the rock band, which I don't think it worked as well as it should have. So,
or of course, after a little bit, you start to release your own album, your own project. That today is with Ring of Fire, if I'm wrong. Yes, yeah. Gravity is been released. Gravity, but of course, you had a lot of albums being released before that your project turned out into Ring of Fire, and this shows as well that I started
Ring of Fire 20 years ago, actually. So yeah, there's been a lot of time in between albums because I'm doing so many other things, but. Yeah. Yeah, but the new album we did came out November last year, so just recently,
So, and this album is seeing like your change, man, you can say your change during the years of as musician, but as well show how much you are a polyedric artist. So if you would, for example, describe in, even with one word, your journey in this album, until Gravity, how would you describe that? Because of course we're going to speak about Gravity more, of course.
You mean my whole life?
Yeah, this journey with your own solo project, with your project.
Oh.
Yeah. If you can say as well with your own life, you can do both. Two objectives.
I don't know how to put it into one word. I've had so many experiences. I need to write a book, actually.
You can say just a book. That's just a word.
The book is coming.
That's great. and about the Willy, and because of course you see, so I guess you see changes from, for example, the first album, Ignition, I think it was, and the last one, Gravity. How much has changed? I mean, during all these years.
I think it's progressed. I think I've progressed in quality. I think I sing better now than I ever have. I think my voice has a little more depth, and I definitely have more control. I was blessed with a great singing voice. I don't mean to sound egotistical, but I consider it a blessing. I was able to sing without having training or anything. I just learned from doing. Later on, when I started doing some classical stuff, I had a vocal coach. But other than that, I never had any school or anything. I taught myself everything. I taught myself how to read music and play instruments. I forgot the question now.
About of course that it says there were differences. Of course, about not following the sound and the techniques and the influencing in all this album until Gravity.
I dive into all my experiences, I guess, to each time I come out with something new, and use all of the things that I've learned. I don't know. I think this album, Gravity, is probably one of the best of the Ring of Fire albums. I've had the greatest musicians playing on, and it's a different band this time, except for Vitaly.
Which is an amazing musician as well.
Yeah, but Vitaly and I are basically the core of that band. So, he's a crazy guy. I love him, but he's completely in the classical. His mind is in the classical world, but he loves to rock out too. So,
and about Gravity, we can say there is a main topic that you talk in Gravity, or I don't know, a topic that you always love to talk in music, and or you would love to talk.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
If there is a topic that you already talk for, that you really love, I don't know, for example, can be, I don't know, your journey in life, whatever, and or you would like to write about it, talk about it.
I may start. I'm working on some other new stuff for this year already with several albums, and one of them will be a solo album. And I may write more about my own experiences.
So it's going to be your own. So it's going to be Mark Boals just released. Well, yes. That's amazing. So it's going to be, what could you say about it? Just only what could you say? Because of course, we're curious.
Disclaimer is that won't be the only thing that I do, because there will be maybe 3 or 4 albums this year that will come out.
Wow. They're going to be basically, go on.
I'm very, very busy at the moment. So, and very happy. I'm happy to work nonstop on music. It's my life and it's what I love doing. So.
Yeah. And of course, I'm thrilled to know about this new, because you released Gravity like November, and three or four albums will be out this 2023. And basically there is, for all your fans, there will be almost, every month something new. That's amazing, and congratulations.
Not every month, but
I mean the songs leave.
I can't work that fast, but I wish I could work that fast, but no, I think a little longer than that.
Of course, I mean, you, in all your career, we can say that you work with a lot of talented musicians as you, and they work with you talented as well. There was some musicians, like, you just not say just one, maybe that you felt really, I don't want to say feelings, but you felt that maybe they influenced you in the way of singing or composing. So let's say composing during all your career.
I never thought about that. I'm influenced by everybody that I work with, because I'm always looking for ways to improve anything that I do. So, but I couldn't say who influenced my singing.
In general, composing.
Not necessarily the people that I work with. It's the people that I listen to.
Let's go with that. So your musical influences, because of course, this is a question that it's been marked. Mark Boals influences.
Oh, well.
Yeah.
That's flattering. I don't know, but I guess probably I pass along my influences that from the people that have influenced me. You know, it's a circle.
That's amazing. And I mean, when you were, you know, like a teenager, for example, just let's say like that, who were the bands, the idol that you were really aspiring to be? If you ever had any,
The singers were the Ian Gillan, Ronnie James Dio, Bruce Dickinson. But I loved pop singers and R&B singers too. So, I mean, I took a little
That's
bit
beautiful.
Because nobody did exactly what I do, I don't think, because I have a little bit of a different sound, and I've always had a real high tenor voice.
Yeah, that's why your voice you have your own, you can say your own sound, your mark, your print.
When I was starting out, I tried to sound like everybody else. That's what everybody does. Like I really tried to sound like them, and I figured out at one point that I'm not going to sound like them no matter what I do. So I should try to sound like, just natural, like my best.
Yeah, of course. Basically, you answered one of my last questions. It was your current project, because you said that you were working about album and about lives. There are some lives that you are planning to do in 2023, some gigs here and there, festivals, items.
Well, I'm trying to put some shows together for Ring of Fire for Europe, but
that's amazing.
I haven't done any, you know, it's hard to get the promoters, because I didn't have a website, I don't have followers on Ring of Fire. It's kind of considered new, because it was 8 years since I did the last album. It was a lot of years between that album and the one before, plus my other projects. It's not easy, and I don't have management for Ring of Fire. So for me, I'm so busy. I hope we can do some shows. I'm probably going to go and do a little show in Finland with Mirka Rantanen. Yeah. He has a rock and roll circus rock and roll, something like that.
With circus,
one song on his album, he has a bunch of singers on there, like Jeff Scott-Soto and Johnny Jewel. New album coming out, and he wants me to come to Finland. So I'm probably going to do that. I'll probably do some shows in Japan, but I don't know if it will be with Kelly Simon or with Ring of Fire. Okay. Or. But it's nothing. solid yet, except for May. In May, I will be in Finland for a week. So,
you're going to be in Europe as well. But I'm not wrong, because I'm in Sicily, in Palermo, a small island. I remember that you played here in Palermo, which is really a huge event. I don't know if you remember of playing here in Sicily back at the time, because it was the anniversary of Trilogy, if I guess.
Oh yeah.
I don't remember. If you remember, if you have some, of course. I mean, it didn't happen yesterday. Of course, happened years ago. If you remember that particular gigs, and how do you feel? Do you saw the Sicilian crowd? Like, just your own thought about that night.
It was a great night. I do remember that, because it was the first time I was ever in Palermo. First time ever in Sicily, actually. And I have a lot of friends from Sicily, though, so it's the first time I was ever there. I really had a lot of fun. We were just going around in a van and playing small places. It's really fun for me to play the small places, because you get to be right close to the people and you see their faces, reaction from your performance. And a lot of times in the big places, you don't really feel the crowd. You feel the crowd, but you can't really see the faces and the reaction the same. You feel it.
Yes, of course. There are big stadium, big venues, and of course when it's smaller, you perceive as
both.
Well the energy.
I love both, don't get me wrong. I love both.
Yeah, I mean.
I haven't had the experience of playing the small places so much in my life, so I enjoy it. Can do that. And we were driving through these small, we played a bunch of places in Italy and small towns, small, driving through small villages, and you stop for lunch in a small little village.
Yeah.
The food is amazing. People are, I love Italy. I have so many Italian friends.
And that's before ending, that's like I told you in the beginning, editor-in-chief Domenico, that he met you actually when you were here, and you signed to him, I think, an autograph or something.
Okay.
And he was the one who talked with you, and he's a really big fan of you. So before ending, if you just could say greetings, because he worked really hard for this interview.
Okay, his name is Domenico?
Yeah, exactly, yes.
Okay, all right, I will.
Okay.
Now?
Sure.
Say, hi Domenico, cheers brother. Peace, great to meet you. I hope I see you again.
So what could I say, Mark? I mean, it was really a pleasure meeting one of the best and huge vocalists of all the time. I mean, allow me to say that. I listened to 80s music. I really love, I don't know, that Coverdale, Jan Matijevic. But your voice, it's still intact today.
Well, I didn't mention. Yeah, Coverdale was one of my influences, too. I Yeah, of course. He was a Deep Purple singer, so, and Rainbow.
I think about that as well. So you're as well, this a huge vocalist, and I want to say just artist, because any musician, it's an artist, because you express your own art. And the things that I really feel that I want to tell you is that always keep on doing this like you're doing, because you're really an inspiration to all these young kids outside. They are learning and discovering, you know. For me, it's the right, not the right type of music, but that's, you know, everyone has their own taste.
Right.
So with your music, these young guys, they discover the music, the hard rock, the beginning, or we can say of everything. So thank you, Mark, and hope to see you, I don't know, in some gigs, in some festival. I will be in the north as well this summer, so who knows?
I hope I can come back to Sicily. I love it.
We would love to have you here again as well. I mean, you have a huge fandom here, so they love you here.
Okay. All right, sounds good. Nice to meet you.
It was a pleasure. Thank you so much, and have a good day. Thank you so much, Mark.
Yeah.